you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose again as your Savior? Yeah. And third, do you promise to follow him the rest of your life as your King?
Absolutely.
Awesome. Well, then it is my joy to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We are buried in life with Christ and raised to walk in new life. First, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
Yes.
Second, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose again to give you a new life?
Yes.
Third, you promise to follow him the rest of your life as your King?
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Go ahead and put your left hand over there. Bend your knees. It is my joy to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We are buried in life with Christ and raised to walk. Three questions. First, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
Are you getting it?
Second, do you believe that Jesus died for your sins and rose again as your Savior?
Oh, I did.
Aubrey, shut up.
And third, y'all over there. Third, do you promise to follow him the rest of your life as your King?
Yes.
Amen. Well, it's my joy to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. You're buried in life with Christ and raised to walk in new life. All right, Emma, three questions. First, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
Yes.
Second, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose again as your Savior?
Yes.
Third, do you promise to follow him the rest of your life as your King?
Obviously.
Obviously. I like that. All right, take your left hand and put it over your nose. There you go. And bend your knees with me, all right? It is my joy to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in life of Christ and raised to life.
Am I on? Okay, now we got it. All right, so if I go down this morning, I'm taking two more with me. Rachel, would you pray?
I thank you for this day, Lord. I thank you for the many blessings that you've given us. Lord, I thank you for the outpouring of your Spirit that we saw through the youth this week while they were on their mission trip. And I thank you so much for four new brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord. I pray that this church would wrap their arms around each of those youth that accepted you as their Lord and Savior, Lord, and that we would continue to walk with them daily as they grow in their relationship with you. And I pray that you would just wrap your arms around us as we go through this service today, and that you would be with our praise team and Brian as we lift high the name of the Lord this morning. And I pray these things in the name of your precious and holy Son, Jesus. Amen.
If everybody would stand, we'll start with Jesus Messiah.
Body the bread, his blood the wine.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for this day and thank you for this church. And Lord, thank you for being with us as we was as a youth team, as we was gone last week. Just thank you for your protection, your watch care over us. And Lord, I just pray that that as we go through this service, that you'll just be with each one who speaks this morning, Lord. Just calm their nerves, and I just pray that you'll just be with them. Just be with Brother Brian as he leads us this morning. And Lord, just be with this team that leads us in music and worship this morning. And Lord, thank you for the baptisms that we had as we was gone last week, Lord. And just be with them as they serve you, Lord. And Lord, just thank you again for so much. And just be with us during this service. In your son's precious name that I pray. Amen.
I love seeing a youth group in a church like this grow and be there because they are the church right now. I know we like to say sometimes that the youth are the church of tomorrow, but no, they're the church of right now because they... There's a generation right now that We'll get it in a minute. Yeah, I think so. They have a chance to reach a generation that we don't. A generation that they need Jesus. So, you know, like Rachel said in her prayer, we need to come around these youth as a church and support them in any way possible. But if you would stand, our next hymn is 405, Have Faith in God. Have faith in God when your pathway is lonely. He sees and knows all the ways you have tried. Never alone, all the least of his children. Have faith in God, have faith in God. Have faith in God, he's on his throne. Have faith in God. The third verse wasn't up there. We don't have no screens back here this morning. This is the only one we got. All right. So I think I'm going to let Rachel do this one because it's a little out of my range. Rachel?
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. I still got joy in King.
That we have a God who won't fail us. He is our firm foundation, right? Yeah, I'll move. I got you. We good? All right. Couple quick church life events before I turn it over for our youth to share about our mission trip that we went on down to the mountains. First of all, I want to remind you that tonight is the fifth Sunday fellowship. We are going to be coming together tonight at 6 o'clock just to celebrate and to have some fun with one another. And we're kind of doing a makeup tonight of our Independence Weekend celebration. We, you know, just had a few thunderstorms. We had 3 tornado warnings, no big deal. And so it kind of cut short our Independence Weekend fun. We didn't get to throw off any fireworks. We didn't get to finish the cornhole tournament and name me champion. We didn't get to finish any of that. And so tonight at 6 o'clock, we are going to come back and kind of send summer out with a bang here in the final Sunday of July. So I encourage you to come out. We'll have food. We'll have some fun. We'll resume the cornhole tournament. We'll have fireworks once it gets dark outside. I hope to see you tonight at 6. And then I want to let you know that coming up this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, our midweek worship is back. We are back on regularly scheduled programming with our youth, kids, and adults all getting together this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And so just go ahead, get that back on the calendar. We took a couple weeks off to let our workers breathe, our kids and student volunteers to take a moment or to just to go off and do mission work. And now we're going to be back on regular scheduled programming this Wednesday night. So I hope that you are ready for that. And speaking of what's going on with our youth on Wednesday nights, we've got an amazing group of students in this church. I could not be more thrilled and excited about what's going on in our student ministry. And they're going to come up and share some of that with you. So y'all, come on up.
We're all a team, so everybody get on up behind us. Ronnie, you too. You can get on up here too. You want to?
You going to come, Sam?
All right, I don't see any more green shots. Jordan. Come on, Jordan. Are you coming up? You can stand back behind us.
All right, so Jeannie and I are going to go first for that. But first of all, we want to say thank you. Thank you to the church. Thank you to everyone who has donated money, who's donated time, and anything, prayers for us this past week. The devil started out at us at the beginning, He knew great and wonderful things were going to happen at this trip. So about, how far down the road did we go, Sam? Where were we? We were on the other side of Corbin, and we had two flat tires immediately. Boom. So we were on the side of the road for about 3.5 hours with this wonderful group of teenagers who did an amazing job, I will say, of just hanging out and just playing games and eating snacks that several of you all donated, thank you very much, that we had on the bus, and just kind of hung out with each other for that. So the devil knew wonderful things were going to happen this week. There was wonderful, lots of wonderful things. Kind of one of the first things that we did, and you all, in the beginning, you all saw a lot of the pictures in which we saw. One of the first things we did, we went to a place called Camp Howard. And this is a camp that had actually not, since like 2019, hadn't been used. But anyway, we painted two buildings there. We cleaned up a camp. We cleaned up fence rows. So mom and daddy and granny and grandpas, you think your kids can't paint and weed eat and all this kind of stuff? They can. Okay. They weed eated, they painted, they cleaned out fence rows, they cleaned up trash. So just an FYI, so they can. So for that, and they did an amazing job with that, with minor amount of complaining. Okay. And so, but they did anything we asked them to do, they were on it. So we were so proud of all their hard work that day. And these pictures in which you all saw will never, ever, ever show the amount of dedication and the amount of hard work and the love that went on this week. It could never show that. This is an amazing group of kids, and I'm so proud of them, and I love them dearly. Jeannie's going to talk about some other things we did real
quick. I want to thank you all, too, for sharing your child with us. They not only, we were there to support them and encourage them, but they showed us a lot of things, and I'll talk about that later. But we stayed at a place called Christ Hands Camp, and we didn't tell the kids all this stuff before we got there, but it used to be a prison camp, okay? And it had turned into a nonprofit camp, so it was all grown up and everything, so it didn't look the best when we got there, but when we left, it looked like better than you could imagine, okay? So we've painted three buildings there, and there was a pond that was all grown up. They weed-eated, and they cleared out a long path all around the pond. I just can't tell you how big of a space they cleared out. I think some of them worked on a sign, and it was just amazing. In fact, one of the youth, and I won't mention names, but I heard that she said, "We paid all this money to come up here, and all we're doing is working." And, you know, that made a lot of sense, because at this point, we were so physically tired, and we were worn out, and I was thinking, you know what, that makes a lot of sense. She knows what she's talking about, because the leaders were even getting a little worn out. And what they didn't know, though, was this money only, it paid for our room and board. It paid for our food, our meals, and it also paid for inflatables and things for the mission work that we did. Like, you know, we did a block party. But that was a lot that happened on the place that we actually stayed. All right, you want to?
Okay, the next thing we did real quick was we had a block party. We actually had with a local Baptist church that was down there. One of the nights, all of us kind of gathered together, kind of like our block party we have here at the end of summer and that kind of stuff, inflatables and all the area kids came, and we just had a blast. Face painting, you saw several of the kids' faces painted. So we just had an absolute blast spending time with the local kids and just hanging out with them, telling them that, you know, that Jesus loves them, and just pretty much just playing and eating what Baptists like to do. So those type of things, and just loving on those kids for an evening with that. We also, one of the things also, that next day, that next morning, did you want to talk about the canvassing? You want me to?
You tell them about the Boys and Girls Club.
Okay, then we went to a Boys and Girls Club. We had a Boys and Girls Club that was down the road. We couldn't take any pictures of them because it was the Boys and Girls Club, but we went in there and just hung out with the kids. It was like a large daycare for kids anywhere from like, I don't know, first grade up to, some of them were middle school kids, and we played games with them, we colored with them, and just hung out, and the kids have lots of great stories from that camp. that we actually played with the kids that day. So we had lots of fun with that day. So we did that. You want to go to the next one?
All right. Yeah. So then comes Wednesday. We're mentally tired. We're physically tired. Some of us had breakdowns with some tears. Some of us were tired of each other, okay? We had a schedule, but when you work with youth, you'll learn quick that you have to be flexible. We would get up early in the morning, and they were supposed to be in bed at a certain time and lights off at a certain time. We never did that. But
11 o'clock was bedtime.
It was supposed to be. Boo, no, it wasn't. Not for this group. So something happened amazing on Wednesday. We always got up every morning. We had devotion. At the end of the day, we talked about what we did. Our kids would share stuff, and we sang. But there was something happened on Wednesday evening that we didn't plan, and the group that was, you know, in charge of this, they didn't plan. But we went there, you know how people do in church, and you know youth groups do it, everybody's in a little clique, and they've got their own little clique and their own little friends they hang out with. Well, we realized that we may have a little trouble this year, because last year we took 11. They were fired up, came back, and this year we had 19. So we had some different cliques. What happened on Wednesday night, we had a little service, and these youth taught me something. And they taught all the adults there something. They taught us that night how to worship God. And, you know, a lot of times I don't know about you all, but there's times I want to raise my hand, and I don't raise my hand in church because I'm afraid my next-door neighbor might think, oh, what is she raising her hand for, you know? These kids went in there, and they prayed. There was some that gave testimonies about that what they were going through. And they not only did this with our group. There was a group there from Pennsylvania. They cried out to God. They came and got on the altar, and they prayed. And when one prayed, they laid hands on one another. And, y'all, that wasn't planned. We didn't plan that. That was a God thing. And that service was supposed to start at 9, and y'all know what our bedtime was, as Tanya said. We did not leave that church service till about 1 o'clock in the morning. We sat back and we let...
Wasn't it one?
Okay, all right. So, Brian, you remember that if you want to go over today. But it wasn't us. That was not a planned thing. God took over, and these kids, they came together, and the cliques, there was no more cliques from that point on. They was hugging on each other. They encouraged each other the rest of the week. And they became one. And that's what we prayed for. We prayed before we went that our group would get along with the Pennsylvania group. They got along from day one. And I just want to say, you know, it wasn't about just teaching them something. I learned something. And I thank God for that opportunity.
Another quick thing in which we did, one day also, kind of our free day we had, we went to Kingdom Come State Park. And we let them just kind of have a free afternoon. And some kids learned how to fish. Some kids learned how to paddle boat. Learn direction. if you ever been in a paddle boat for that. So they had a little bit of a fun free day for that. And another thing is that they did real quick is we canvassed like the town. One morning we went in and it was one of the little local towns. And these kids were very bold. That was a word in which I discovered this week that we used often was boldness. These kids, we told them, okay, you're going to go to a town that you've never been to. You don't know anybody there. And we're going to tell you, knock on the door. Okay? So they knocked on the door, and every one of these kids knocked on the door. The person, some answered, and they asked them, you know, what is something which I can pray for you for? And these kids prayed with individuals. Every one of these kids prayed for people's needs of that county. What a blessing that was to see these kids do that. There were, these kids got preached to. I think somebody got preached to in a car. Somebody stopped them on the side of the road and just told them what a blessing that they were. But that sometimes can be intimidating to us adults. But these kids hit it head on. And they didn't ask questions. They knocked on the door and prayed for individuals who ever entered the door. So boldness is a word that I used often this week. So You all be very proud of these young adults. Very, very much so. Okay. Now we're going to let them. Did you have anything, Angie? Angie?
I'll say something.
All right. Kiddos.
I just want to start off by thanking everybody that gave some donations, because it wouldn't have been possible without you guys. And to start it off, when we, on our way there, like they mentioned, we had the flat tire, and we was on the side of the road for like 3 hours, and we was complaining like the whole time. And then there was like this little creek, and me and Caden and some of us, who was like messing around just to have something to do to pass the time. Well, when we finally got there, we figured it wouldn't be that bad. But then Monday, when we had to do all the painting and it was hot and brutal, we was complaining. And then most of us was thinking, this is going to be, it's not going to be that good like it was last year. But then Tuesday came after we met the Pennsylvania people, and we realized it was going to be a pretty good one if we stuck together and really just worked hard as a youth and as a team in general. And Wednesday was a really emotional and great experience for all of us, I would say. We worshiped, and some of us prayed that don't usually pray, and some of those who did pray, they prayed hard and they prayed well. And I would just like to say, JL, I am extremely proud of you. I'm very proud of you for coming out and doing what you did. I'm really proud. And I'm just proud of everybody for being honest and saying stuff that most people don't know about them. I'm just proud that they came out and the way that they did, and just to, they were just being honest with the whole youth. Because I know it's not hard to be honest with just strangers you met just 2 days ago. So I would just like to say that I'm proud, and I'm very thankful to have these youth and this church. And that's all I got.
All I really want to say is that it really touched, like, everybody. There wasn't just a few people who got touched. Everybody was touched. It was just a very emotional time, just to let all your feelings out, and you really felt welcomed by the Pennsylvania kids and just everybody there. It was a really good time. Yeah, that's all I got.
I've only told a few people this in the group, but before the mission trip, I prayed to God. I said, let there just be one heart changed on this mission trip. Let just one person follow you for the rest of their life. And God not only did that, but I think he changed each and everybody's heart on this mission trip, and then some, and blessed their life for the rest of their life. And I pray that everybody would follow God for the rest of their life, and their faith would be brought back to Gary County and not be left on the mountains. That's all I got.
Who's getting
next? Just like everybody else, to say the least, that the mission trip was very much life-changing. I came back and I didn't feel the same as I did before. Like, I felt like something was fulfilled in my heart. Like, there's been something missing for a while. We all made like really great connections with each other, and not just as like, I feel like these people are now my family more than just people I see two times a week. Like, I've can talk to them about anything. It's grown me a lot closer. Like, I was really losing faith and trust because so much was going on. And it just helped me so much to realize and understand that my heartache isn't what I am. Like, I'm more than what I'm going through. I'm more than what my family's going through. I'm more than my pain. Like, I can be somebody. And it was just really life-changing, and I just feel really, like, fulfilled with joy and love, and I just feel something that I haven't really felt in a long time, and I just really hope that all of these people, they're so wonderful from just everywhere, that they can feel the same way that I feel now, and they can understand that they're worth more than what they really think they are. So that's pretty much it.
So I'm gonna start off by saying, like, I'm new to being here. I, like, was finding a church, and this was the first church I went to, and I instantly connected. When I came here, I didn't think I would be going on this trip because I didn't know anybody. But now that I've came back from it, I feel like I have a whole new family. And I know that everybody in this group I can talk to, and I know that this church is my church, and that I'm not going anywhere. Mm-hmm. And I'm really happy that I moved here and that I met everybody, and just this trip was so touching, and I've never felt closer to God in my life. That Wednesday night, I felt his presence, and I have never prayed over anybody before, but I sat there and I prayed for everybody who needed it, and I prayed my heart out, and I'm willing to do that plenty more times for anybody who needs it, because this is my family.
Okay, you guys. Okay, I promised myself that I was not going to cry during the speech, because that's not happening. So I wrote this the night after the mission trip. I was just sitting in my room, and I was listening to this worship thing that a person from Pennsylvania did, and it was just, I just kept writing, and it was just really touching to me, and I was going to say it for this speech today, so here we go. Okay, it says, so last Sunday started one of the best weeks I think I've ever had in a long time. Every mission trip I have ever went on, there is always something that goes wrong, whether that be someone not getting along or something that changes. But the group we have always gets the best out of those moments. I think Wednesday was probably one of those days that our team really saw each other. We saw sides of us that a lot of people have not seen. We had probably the best worship that night. Jesus was in that chapel. He touched all of us and let us all see what people actually go through. We stayed in that chapel from like 9 till 1 or so, and it was just awesome how we got to experience that. Truly, the group we have is family, and yes, we all have our ups and downs, but at the end of the day, we always find our way back to each other and always have each other's backs. I just want to thank all of the youth group leaders in the church that let us have these opportunities. A lot of people don't get to have these, so just to experience this is just one step forward to our world with Christ. Some of us are not here today, but the ones that are, I'm so glad that we all got to experience this. I had a great week with you guys, and I'm glad that we all got to do this. This trip and last trip, I think, taught us all not to take things for granted. You don't ever realize how much we actually have. It's crazy to go to these places and see the little things people have, and the way they are still going because of people like our group is amazing. So that was all I had.
Hi. I just wanted to say that everybody here had an amazing time, and we complained about everything, like the work, and I heard somebody here say, oh man, this sucks. Sucks that I had to pay $100 to go work. But I feel like the $100 was worth it in a way, because not only did it bond us all together like family, but it taught us about patience and everything like that. I'm really proud of JL for doing what he did, Aubrey. And there's one person here that I've bonded with in more than a month than I did in a week. And his name's Wyatt. After Wednesday, he walked up to me and said the best thing in the world to me. He said, "Man, you helped me. This helped me." And he just walked up to me and gave me a hug. And I sat there and I was like, wow. All of this changed everybody here. Imagine what we could do when we go and canvas. So we went out, and this is my personal experience. I'm pretty sure I told everybody here about it. I knocked on the door, or no, I didn't knock. She was sitting there on her front porch, and I walked up to her, and I asked her, how's your day? And she said in the sweetest voice, everything's amazing. I couldn't be any better. And we talked about what we were doing, and in the end, I asked her, do I have anything to pray for you about? And she said, no, but I'd like to pray for you. And we sat there for about 2 minutes. Everybody had walked down, went to a different part. And in the end, she just said, thank you and I love you. And gave me the biggest hug in the world. And I was starstruck by it. This person that I don't know the name of, and still don't know the name of, that I just met about 5 minutes ago, prayed for me, told me I love you, and sent me on my way. It just shows the stuff that you can do for people and the stuff that can happen for you at the end of it.
I found out this week that I've got several cousins in this church. I'm usually, around the boys, I always say, Bud. You know, hey, how you doing, Bud? Put my arm around them. But we got so tight this week, we went from Bud to Cuz. So every time we was walking up, we was bumping fists, say, how you doing, Cuz? But great week. And I do want to appreciate this church. This church always support the youth, always. I've been here several years, and this church is great about supporting the youth. And I have one of the young ladies that was there toward our last day. She sat down with me and we talked for a while, and she just kind of tell me about her life and, you know, some pretty rough things. Family life, but she said, you know, she'd been to other churches and stuff before, but she says it's the first time she really felt like she was part of a family. So, you know, these kids, they work, amazing group. I wouldn't trade any of them for anything. They're just a great group. Now, the guy's room we stayed at, it was pretty rough in that kind of that dorm area. You open that door, and all you can smell was feet. You know? as soon as you walk in, so that was kind of a rough week for that. But kids worked hard, just to enjoy each other, and I'm impressed also. And kind of Jean was saying too about these kids got up there, and you know, they's praising the Lord, and it seemed like, you know, like she was saying. You know, it seemed like, you know, my hand almost come up, you know, something's kind of pulling it back down. You know, you just can't get it up there. But, you know, we got a Heavenly Father that we need to praise, and we need to do it. And one thing I had took away from this trip that I kind of learned from myself, we went to that town, and we kind of broke up. The leaders kind of took like four kids with them and spread out and went house to house. But the preacher is saying, you know, hey, you know, we're dropping, how we do here sometimes, we drop something off at the door, you know, telling about the church. But he said, you know, if nobody's home, you know, you just don't leave it there at the door and walk away. You go ahead and pray for that house. Anybody that answers the door and you ask them, you know, if they had any kind of prayer concerns, I mean, you heard a lot. People was, you know, had surgeries, wives sick, children sick, you know, and just a lot of hurting people out there. And first time I ever did this for, there was a guy that was driving by, and we crossed an intersection, and he stopped at the stop sign. So I just went up to him. We all went up, and I think he was 71 years old, and his wife had passed away, but he was raising a 4-year-old grandson. But he kind of poured his heart out to us, you know, sitting there at the stop sign. And then he turned around, when we got done talking to him, he kind of gave the kids a little sermon. He said, "My life," he said, "I was, you know, drinking and doing drugs and stuff when I was young. I tried to straighten up and finally did." And he was trying to tell the kids, he says, "There's a lot of little shiny objects out there for you. But," he said, "stay away from them." He said, "you got to draw close to the Lord." And he was telling me, he said, "I get up about an hour and a half when my grandson gets up." And he said, "I read my Bible." He said, "I'm praying." And I said, "you know, the grandson's in a good spot then, you know, if he's got you for, you know, to help him out." But I learned that Saturday I went to town and stopped at Five Star. I had a gentleman come up to me and say, "Hey, my brother had a stroke. I'm getting ready to head to Lexington to go ahead and see him." And he said, "Will you pray for him?" And I said, "Yes." I said, "I'll pray for him." And I said, "I'll tell Jenny, you know, pray for him." So I walked out of Five Star, and, you know, by the time I got toward my car, I said, "You know, well, what are you doing?" You know, he's right there. You know, go ahead and pray for him right now. So I turned around and went back to him and, you know, put my hand on his shoulder. But that kind of learned me a lesson down there is, you got the opportunity, you know, don't walk away from it. You know, God went ahead and put you there, you know, at that time, and really just thank God for the opportunity that he gave you. But again, even though as old as I am, and when I feel like kind of like a grandfather to all these, but I love him more than anything. And I do appreciate this church for all we do.
All right, so Wednesday was probably one of the strangest nights that ever happened to me. There was like 1,000 things going on at like one time. And what on Wednesday, what really touched me was everybody just everybody was listening to God, everybody was talking to God, everybody was praying, preaching, everything was like going on. I couldn't even register what was going on because everything was going on at one time. And I don't know what happened Thursday and Friday because I missed. I was at camp. These guys made me sick. It was like at this church thing, it was like this lunch, it was like pink and bubbling. They told me to like eat it, and I ate it, and then I threw up 3 times right after. And then I missed Thursday and Friday. I couldn't even walk, I was so dizzy. But I just prayed Thursday night that it would just help me get better, and then Friday I didn't feel a thing. I just felt God working in my body and my mind Wednesday also. And, yeah.
All right, so Mom's been over here bugging me, trying to, wanting me to say something else. So Wednesday, I made a little devotion, put a little devotion together, and I said the devotion Wednesday, and right after that, then God just was here, and it just, I don't know what made everybody just open up, but I don't know if it was my devotion, or I don't know what it was, but I don't know what it was. But Yeah, all right. Now, I think that's it. Okay.
Okay, I just want to say one quick thing. I am super proud of these kids. I'm honored to be part of this youth group. I love them so much, and I feel like they all bonded, and I know I bonded so much more with these kids. Like, they're mine, and I love them so much. But that's about it.
Jack says she's not just your mom, she's our mom.
Yes, I am. Okay, so at this Boys and Girls Club, guys, listen, I didn't know that 8-year-olds dated. I'm talking, he cheated on her with 2 different girls. And then we told her. She was heartbroken. I healed a heartbreak. I was so proud of myself. This one, you know, instigated a fight. She got kicked out of daycare. She punched him in the face. After he called her crusty. But the lesson here is don't let your 8-year-olds date each other, because then they get kicked out of daycare and they don't get to go on field trips. So that's basically it.
Justice for justice.
Justice for justice.
I'll be quick. I know we're pressed for time, but we are so blessed to have this group of kids, and I love them dearly with all my heart. And it was heartbreaking. I had to leave early, so I was told that I had to leave to allow the Spirit to come in and work. So I guess not my sacrifice, but you know, it's amazing. You know, we see them all the time, and we're with them a lot, and just to see the growth. I know it's something you all don't know that you all see like we do, but the growth in this bunch of kids is amazing. Just seeing how they grow and how they've, you know, some of them have come, and it's just like Kenzie is now part of the family. And you know, I think some of the times it's hard, guys, when we're there and doing stuff, you wonder, you know, how is this honoring God, and how what are we doing here? We're painting and we're working in the dirt and cutting trees and stuff like that. But you know, God works all the time. He works all the time. And there's definitely times there that we were seeing God work, and I wasn't there, unfortunately. But you know, we were seeing God in their midst right there. But there's times that we don't, and we do wonder. And you know, I think last year's mission trip, you know, it started out kind of rocky. We had a group from Tennessee, and we had some serious talks and some awesome devotions and about how we should be as Christians, and I think that it bled over into this year, would you all not say? I mean, when we came together with the Pennsylvania crew, I mean, we just, our hearts were where they should have been, and their hearts were where they should have been, and we just bonded with them, and it just worked out really good. So a year later, God worked in last year's situation, I think, just by intervening and teaching us something last year for this year. So, but you all, I love you guys, and these are amazing, amazing kids. We have such an awesome group, and Jeannie and Kurt and Tanya and Sam, and just amazing how what they do and what they do for this church. So thank you all very much.
Thank you.
dance and sing to I Thank God. It was a song that we like all loved at the trip, basically. So if you were confused on what we were doing, that's what we're doing.
Bag of bones. Y'all really think I'm gonna preach after all that? Come on now. Here's what I'm gonna do, because I think we've heard our sermon by and large today. I do. So let me just share with you my experience with them real quick as we close out and go into a time of response. I hopped up in the middle of this week. I joined them on Wednesday, and I got to be there just a few hours before I saw an outpouring of the Spirit that I have never experienced before in my life. I saw something Wednesday night that I had never seen. Not in a church, not in a student ministry trip, not on a mission trip, not at a conference. I watched student-led worship. Not student leader-led, not student leader organized, not student leader run. No, I watched teenagers say, "We want to have a worship service." I saw teenagers say, "We want to sing to the Lord." I saw teenagers say, "I feel led to share a word from God." I saw teenagers testifying to what God has done in their life. I saw teenagers screaming out and crying to their Lord. I saw teenagers laying hands on each other and praying in a way that I don't know where they learned how to do it, except that the Spirit of God filled their heart. I saw teenagers crying and holding each other up for 1 hour, for 2 hours, for 3 hours, for 3.5 to 4 hours. They went with all of us adults sitting in the back just watching. That's not something man can create, y'all. What's happening in our students right now is not of man. That is of the Spirit of God. In my original text today, what I was supposed to preach, but I think the kids have kind of preached it for me. With Psalm 11, it says, "I have taken refuge in the Lord. How can you say to me, 'Escape to the mountains like a bird?' For look, the wicked string bows. They put their arrows on bowstrings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. And when the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? And that's what the world is trying to teach us. It's what the world is trying to teach our kids. That's what oftentimes...